Thank you. And it's good that we are having a PD meeting, although in a lunch symposium, in this overall hemodialysis kind of dominated conference. So, you know, when we were sitting here, we were feeling rather warm, and some of us took off the jackets. So one of my friends, a senior nephrologist, commented that, you know, there's a PD symposium, so there's no funding, so they've put off the AC. So that is a fantastic statement in the sense that that is one of the reasons for the degrowth of PD. Let me begin with that. There's no, we cannot come away from the fact that PD is degrowing, and that makes us feel wistful, some of us. If I see an old patient of mine who's doing extremely well, more than 10 years, he comes in once in a while, we often feel that there has been a missed opportunity. And there is no insurance till now. So in fact, there is no funding for PD, even in this country. So one of the missed opportunities is perhaps in the area of cardiorenal syndrome. You know, there are five types. Type one is the acute cardiorenal, type two is the chronic cardiorenal, and we are going to discuss more about the chronic cardiorenal, that's type two, but probably it applies to type one as well. The traditional therapies for cardiorenal syndrome, primarily the cardiac failure, and is diuretics, ACE inhibitors, digoxin, vasodilators, blood transfusions or ESAs to maintain an optimal hemoglobin, and then you have inotropes and the new things like aquaretics and ANPs. Now, if you fail that, you have to come onto devices. The devices are primarily a biventricular pacing in patients who are suitable for that, that every patient is not suitable for that, and the ventricular assist device in selected patients again, and consideration of a cardiac transplant in patients who can undergo that. Short of that, if you're not into the real therapy like that, then you have to depend on some kind of ultrafiltration. The traditional one is by a hemodialysis machine with an equipment, the intermittent ultrafiltration, or you can do with a slow continuous ultrafiltration with a CRRT machine, which is a hydrostatic ultrafiltration, and we can do it by peritoneal dialysis, and what we're doing is osmotic ultrafiltration. So our discussion is between that today, that as to which one is more important. But if you see diuretics and versus ultrafiltration as a whole, then diuretics are simple to use. You don't need any equipment. There are problems of IV volume contraction, renal impairment, electrolyte abnormality, ototoxicity, and resistance, finally, beyond which the diuretics is not going to work. For ultrafiltration, be it peritoneal or machine-driven, you have problems of infrastructure, some more infrastructure required for hemodialysis equipment, renal impairment, anticoagulation, everything, more or less the same. So there are n number of trials for extracorporeal ultrafiltration. I don't want you to read this, but this is the summary that in the last 10 years, there has been four important trials, the rapid CHF, UNLOAD, UltraDisco, and KRS-HF. And all these trials looked at, these are randomized control trials, they looked at diuretics versus extracorporeal ultrafiltration. Given the fact that extracorporeal ultrafiltration is a predictable way of removing the fluid and decongesting the patient. But they found no difference in the renal function, the length of stay, the repeat hospitalization, and in the mortality. So what came out as physiologically it sounded pretty okay, but when you put that into practice, you found there is not much difference, like the early ultrafiltration has no difference from diuretics alone. So this is extracorporeal ultrafiltration. The question is, why so? Why would ultrafiltration not work? Ultrafiltration works, but in a very bad case, you have to temporize the thing, okay. But it's not better than diuretics, where it was supposed to be better than diuretics. So why so? So if we see the model of cardiorenal syndrome, primarily the renal dysfunction is thought to develop from a forward flow problem, which means the heart is not pumping, so there's a problem of forward flow, the kidneys is getting less blood, therefore it is not filtering. Now it's always not so. You think about your own patients coming in cardiac failure, congested, their creatinine is going up, today 2.5, next day 3, next and then 4.5, it's going up like that. Blood pressure is not really low. This patient is having a blood pressure of 130, 135. It's not really a low blood pressure causing that. Then what is actually happening? So you cannot expect the renal component explained by only the cardiac model. So something is happening together, or there are other things. And it is not only the chronic cardiorenal, it is not only somebody with an acute, somebody coming in with an acute LVF also will be having some degree of renal impairment. This has been very well documented in the literature. So you have to actually address the renal component also in this therapy. If you do ultrafiltration, you're looking at the water component only. You're not looking up about the solute component at all. And also the venous congestion, which is and the intra-abdominal pressure. This cannot be tackled by ultrafiltration alone. So theoretically, PD has got a rationale in this area. So PD offers gentle ultrafiltration, which all of us know. And there is no myocardial stunning as opposed to hemodialysis, where this is often a problem in patients who are kind of borderline blood pressure. There is an effective continuous solute clearance, which your ultrafiltration cannot provide, and including sodium and potassium. Very importantly, you can up-titrate the pharmacologic treatment. You can give ACE inhibitors for a longer length of time. You can add ACE inhibitors and aldosterone antagonists because you have no fear of hyperkalemia if you manage them well. So it is possible to give these drugs longer as compared to just if you are doing ultrafiltration alone. And if you drain the ascites well in the setting of CCF, it lowers the intra-abdominal pressure, which also improves the renal hemodynamics and reduces the interstitial pressure within the kidneys and probably helps in recovery. So what should be our prescription in the prescription of PD in the setting of heart failure? We have to depend mainly on colloid osmosis, which means give icodextrin more. As you know, that this sodium sieving effect, icodextrin is a slow kind of ultrafiltration. Therefore, it does not engage the aquaporins. So most of the filtration takes place through the small pores. And when there is a small pore ultrafiltration, the sodium is also taken out. So that is an extra advantage, and you have to depend on colloid osmosis rather than that. The other important advantage is that you can tailor it according to the patient's need. A patient may need a fluid removal only, so one icodextrin may be enough, whereas this same patient over some several months of time may start developing more and more renal impairment, so you can use a larger volume and add to the component, you know, build up on that and get solute clearance. So you can customize to the patient's need.
Sorry and for the interruption. We've just run out of 8 minutes time.
1 minute? Okay. I have almost finished. So this is the kind of a prescription given there, 7.5, one prescription you can build up to the full exchanges. And there have been some trials also in PD in CRS. Most of these trials have been with very sick cases where they are not fit for anything else, and there have been prospective trials and not really a randomized controlled trial. And they have shown some benefit in these patients with the reduction of the number of hospital days. There has been negligible incidence of peritonitis and catheter dysfunction, and there has been improvement of cardiac function as well. So the concerns of PD are the same. This has been discussed again. So the main problem here is that the current literature on the use of PD in the setting of CRS still suffers from significant limitations, and therefore it can hamper its more widespread growth. And more importantly, the PD is not considered by our cardiology colleagues as one of the ways of ultrafiltration. That's a problem. So in summary, it is not just a scientific plausibility statement. This is pathophysiologically and conceptually fairly sound, and it has been reported to be safe and effective in the several clinical trials that has been done here. Now, let me finish by saying that, see, when we train in PD, this was the main procedure that we did, and you are a made man, actually. You are a made man if you did a PD insertion and you did a kidney biopsy. So doing a peritoneal catheter insertion, we never called ourselves interventional nephrologists. We were in the first path of being a nephrologist by putting in a PD catheter. It was quite simple. So we don't need to be an interventional nephrologist to really do that. Probably everyone can do that, and probably we can maybe get it back and not completely forget about PD in this scenario. Thank you.
We will take two questions.
That's a very, very fair comment. Now, my personal feeling as a vascular surgeon, I think, you know, management of chronic kidney disease, one could start off with, in the run-up to ESRD, one could start off with putting up a fistula and waiting for it to mature. And acute dialysis should always be initiated with peritoneal dialysis, and try and avoid catheters to the bare minimum, because they are the root cause of all your fistula failures because of central venous stenosis. So the algorithm could be AVF to ESRD and acute dialysis managed by PD.
Any other?